'cause all I ever wanted, 'cause all I ever wanted was left, left, left. And all we ever wanted was left, left, left.
Ruby Beach.
That's all I ever wanted.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm so glad that you're here with us, Howard Rosh. You guys, welcome to Get It, Got It Good. I am your host, Najwa Wahai Carter. And of course, I'd like to thank, before we even get started, well, WBGR Network and Total Entertainment Radio. So today on today's show, we have Howard Rosh, which I'm really excited about because after, you know, researching you and reading your bio and things like that, you've done a lot of stuff, right? So you guys, we're going to talk to Mr. Rosh when we come right back after these messages, because I want to dive right in with a clean slate. But before we go, you guys, I want to shout out my sponsors really quick, which is One Man Shop is Another. Dance Solutions Youth Outreach, Mission Dance Works, as well as Merlin Prep Academy, and of course, the two networks. So you guys, stay tuned. We're going to jump right in when we get right.
Hey! What's happening, everybody? Now, I know this corona got you tripping, and you ain't showed your homies no compassion in weeks. You probably like, I don't even know how to show my homies compassion. Should I hug them? Ew. Should I dab them? Should I tell them I love them? Ew, no, that's weird. What should I do? This is a tutorial on how to properly dap your partners up. The clothes line. The iris.
His left, his right, and he comes up with a jumper.
Now I got your back. Boom, yeah. The people's elbow.
Sit just right with the people's elbow.
The cowboy. The karate kid. The businessman.
As long as I got my suit and tie.
Last but not least, the Kobe. And remember, you ain't gotta touch your partner's hand to show him you the man. Kid, play. Say the day.
Welcome back, you guys. As promised, we have Howard Rosh with us. And before we even get into some of the accomplishments and accolades that you've had, I actually want to start a little bit with a backstory, because a lot of the times people say, oh, I can never do something. I can't go and be that person because I've started here in these circumstances with these conditions. So before you even go into what you did today, who are you, Howard? Where did you come from? I know you're in Virginia right now, but who are you?
Right. Thanks, Nigel. Thank you so much for having me. That's a question I've been spending most of my life trying to answer. So I'm, it's a great place to start. No, you know, I grew up, I'm 69 years old. So I was born in January 1951. And that's significant because the shadow of World War II was very much over my childhood. I grew up in a Jewish family that came from Eastern Europe. We lost dozens of family members during World War II. We know 43 members of our family died on August 2nd and 3rd, 1942, when the Nazis killed all but 100 of the 5,000 Jews who lived in the community that my grandfather grew up in Western Ukraine, for example. And that's just part of the story. And so the reason I say that is because it really shaped who I am in the world in a very distinct way. I grew up hearing those stories. Mostly they were whispers. They were, you know, as children, we were protected from, you know, the gruesomeness of it all. But we certainly knew that that happened, and we knew that it cast a pall. And my grandfather on my father's side had been an activist. He actually was a person, one of the people who helped form the NAACP in Baltimore, and also put together the group that organized purchase the Harbor, the ship that later went to Europe to try to save Jewish children. Of course, famous movie was made about that. And so there were two very clear messages growing up. One was that terrible things can happen, and the other was you're supposed to do something about it. You know, and so it sort of became, in a way, our family business. My older sister became one of our nation's leading immigration lawyers until she retired just a couple of years ago. Was the head of National Legal Immigration Society and fought for the rights of immigrants. My younger sister was Marion Wright Edelman's fundraiser for many years at the Children's Defense Fund before spending the remainder of her career advising social justice organizations all over the world. And I started my career as a teacher with very young children. And then when I became a school administrator, started doing work expanding the school. And the two things came together when my early civil rights work and my organizational work sort of led me to start doing work with people and organizations around diversity work. So it was an interesting journey that kind of ended up leaving there. And the other piece of it was that I grew up in Washington, D.C., and I've lived in this region my entire life. And of course, as anybody else who lives in this region knows, in where we live, national news is our local news. And so that, I think, contributed to the fact that I became activist and have been one really all my life.
Yeah, most definitely. The DMV area is very diverse, it's very fast moving. Things happen on a regular basis, and we get a lot of politics here because it is our backyard. But that actually clears up a lot of things for me when I'm reading your bio and things like that, because you are very strongly pushing, you know, diversity and things like that. Like, for example, you're an author, you have numerous book titles. Would you like to list some of those? I could, but.
No, sure, I'd be glad to. I mean, my first book, Reinventing Diversity, came out in 2011, and that was really a call for us to look at diversity in a new way, that the same things that we've been doing for 30 years were just not getting us past the peak. And anybody who looks at the numbers knows that. You can see that there's sort of a stalling right now of movement, especially for people of color in corporate America, when we look at a number of people in senior leadership positions. And so it wasn't in any way to diminish what has been done, but just to say in this new reality, the present, we have to look at some new things. And so specifically looking at being, helping people understand what culture means and how to be more culturally competent, looking at things like unconscious bias and how that impacts people's behavior. And then the last piece was to looking at how do we actually change organizational systems. Just doing a training program is not enough, right? And so then the second book, Everyday Bias, came out in 2014. And as the name indicates, was really focused on trying to understand this notion of unconscious bias and how unconscious bias impacts so many of the decisions that we make and so many of the ways we interpret things, as we've seen so sadly in the last couple of weeks around this Ahmaud Arbery shooting and what's been going on in Georgia around that. And that book, you know, just timing being everything in life, sadly came out a month after Michael Brown was shot in Ferguson. So it became a bestseller and, you know, and sort of generated a whole lot of stuff. And then more lately, the last book I wrote in 2018 is called Our Search for Belonging, How Our Need to Connect is Tearing Us Apart, and really speaks to the tribalism in our society and why it is that we form these groups in opposition to each other and, you know, how that's affecting us in our world today. And you know, sadly, it's only gotten worse since the book was written. So we certainly have seen that as we look at the response to COVID and how we immediately have gotten into our tribes and the way we're dealing with that and creating all kinds of crazy and irrational behavior. So, and I'm actually now working on a fourth book with my son, who's just graduating from Berkeley, on a follow-up to the belonging book, and how do we build belonging in organizations? How do we create a sense of real connectedness in organizations? And when people ask me, what do all these terms mean? I say, you know, my dear friend and mentor, Dr. Jeanetta Cole, likes to say that diversity is being invited to the dance and inclusion is being allowed to dance. I like to say belonging is when people get to actually choose some of the music. So they're really that much a part of the organization that their needs are part of the thinking of the organization.
Now, that's a lovely analogy. Now, do you feel that in our attempt to belong, right, and understanding our own, you know, background and history, we create these tribes, but that is counterproductive to that wanting to belong. Do you think that's even ever possible?
Well, I think that the, you know, there's a natural tendency. And one of the things we found when we did the research, and I want to also acknowledge John Robert Tartaglione, who assisted me in writing that book. When we did the research, what we found is that, you know, very much in, when we were doing the work on unconscious bias, Nigel, what we found was that the real breakthrough moment was realizing that we can't exist without bias. It's a fundamental part of our functioning in the world. You know, we automatically make certain assessments about things in order to stay safe. So you don't step into the street and say, I wonder what happens when that big metal object with wheels gets here. You know, you've learned to be careful about cars. You have a bias. We might say you have a bias against cars hitting you. So you operate accordingly. And I think similarly, if we look at our history as human beings, we go back to early days and we would see people around a water hole and we'd have to very quickly make a determination whether it was us or them, because if we made the wrong determination, we would die. So we learn to distinguish between us and them. And this is encoded into our DNA. It's an epigenetic phenomenon that we just will immediately, and you've seen it, you know, you're in your family, you have cliques in your own family, but then when that family's with another family, you all come together against the other family. And then when those two families are against a bigger, you know, so we're constantly moving in and out of these different subgroups that we're a part of. And it helps us know how to be safe in the world. So we're always going to be doing that. But the problem is sometimes we get in these groups for positive reasons, and sometimes we get in them for negative reasons. Sometimes we get into groups because they support us in doing something, because they're fun, because they're engaging. Being with fellow supporters of a football team or a sports team is for fun. You know, there's not, you know, we all, even though we sometimes forget that at the moment, we all rationally know we're not going to die because our team lost. Yeah. You know, it may feel that way at the moment, but we know it's not. We form tribes to accomplish things. You know, for those of us who were in the civil rights movement, that became our tribe. We were trying to accomplish something good. And so that could be a very positive and a very healthy thing. We come together to deal with a tragedy like the Haitian earthquake or something like that. People rally around it. And all of those are really positive. But when we form tribes against something, it can be really negative. And this is what happens when you see Nazism or what happened in Rwanda or what's happening in our country right now, this cold civil war that we're in, where the defining thing for many people is being against Trump. And the defining thing for many people who are Trumpists is being against those liberals or those Democrats or people of color or, you know, Muslims, yeah, or whatever it is. And when we have that kind of coming together against things, we know it could be very toxic and very dangerous.
Most definitely, most definitely. And I think when people understand that this is just how we learn from an early age, the classification, and that's how we learn, then they can understand how unconsciously we can do some of these things based on our upbringing. So, Howard, we have to take a break, but when we come back, I definitely want to talk about the fact that you are a white male, obviously, right?
Oh my God, you're right.
like surprise. But being a white male and speaking out on some of these issues, I'm assuming that it wasn't always the most popular move for you. So I definitely want to talk about some of the love that you got in return for that right after this messages, okay?
Sure, of course.
Research suggests that close to 50% of all small businesses go out of business in their first 2 years. Don't let that be you. Join That's My Network LLC today. Here at That's My Network, we strive to help businesses build their brand by offering connections to multiple marketing streams, including promotion across a social media platform that has a growing following of 50,000 nationwide. Let us help build and develop your brand to reach its full potential. For more information, email thatsmynetwork@gmail.com. That's My Network, a network that works for you.
Welcome back, you guys. Thank you for still being with us. If you're just joining us, we are talking to Howard Ross, activist, author, consultant. I like to call you just a teacher, because all of those,
I like
in
that.
A way, is just about teaching, right?
I think in my heart, that's really what I am. I think that's really a great claims. You know, ultimately, what are you? Yeah, I think teacher is what it is.
Teacher.
You know,
so. And teachers are held at such a high accord when it comes to so many things, and they don't get enough credit. And teachers don't always just come in a form of the school system, right? But in that aspect, you have been teaching about diversity and inclusion and belonging and the different things like that and unbiasedness. But I'm sure as a white male, speaking out for the rights of other socioeconomic and all kinds of groups, that you have come up against some things. So would you like to elaborate on some of the things that you've had to deal with?
Sure. I mean, I don't want to turn this into like some sense of that I've had some oppressed life, because I have all the entitlement of being not only a white man, but a tall white man, which is not insignificant. And I grew up in a middle class home, and we certainly weren't wealthy growing up. My dad ran a Pep Boys store, so we didn't have more money than we needed, but we had as much as we needed. So I had that benefit. And looking at that, to recognize that that's the base that I come from. I came from a base of that same kind of privilege and entitlement that most people who look like me come from in our society. That being said, as I said before, my family story was one of a lot of suffering because of identity, because of Jewish identity in that particular case. And I think that in our home, it was made very clear that treating other people like that was disrespectful. Now, it was in the context of the times, mind you, this was the 1950s. So, you know, we had an African-American maid who would come to our house once a week and the story of the help, that sort of a thing. But it was subtle. Like, for example, if we ever called her by her first name and didn't treat her respectfully, we got all hell from my mother. It was like she was to be treated with respect. My mother, you know, disdained people who talked about the people who came into their homes as the help or things like that. She was somebody who was an honored and appreciated person in our home. And while we look at it in today's context, we might say that's not enough. At the context of the time, it was very clear my mother was making the point. This is what happens. My father similarly told stories about how when he was in the army, he went to get a hotel to stay somewhere with a friend of his who was an African-American man who was another sergeant. And they wouldn't let the guy stay in the hotel. So he ended up sleeping in the car with the guy rather than staying in the hotel. And so whether those stories even happened or not, I don't even know. Were they apocryphal? Who knows what parents tell their children? But it was very clear the message it was being communicated, which is that there's right and wrong in this area. And so it was very natural for, as I said before, for my sisters and I to jump into the fray where that was concerned. Now, when I started doing diversity work back in the mid-1980s, of course, that was very early in the diversity movement, and there were very few white men in the space. And it was interesting because since that time and forever, it's been almost this sort of windshield wiper that keeps moving back and forth. There's sometimes when people say, oh, it's great that you're a white man and you're doing this work. And then there's sometimes, just last week, I'm scheduled to do something for a major university. Somebody says, why is a white guy doing this? And so it goes back to that direction, and then it goes back to the direction. And what I say to people is, look, you know, I don't think somebody has to be Jewish to be sensitive to anti-Semitism and to not want it to be around. I don't think somebody has to be gay to be in support of LGBTQ people's rights. And I don't think people need to be of color to be in support of racial equity. I think that we all have a responsibility to stand for equity in our society, to stand for inclusion, and to stand for belonging for all people. And I hope that people would stand up for the rights of people like me, and I intend to stand up for the rights of other people. And if people don't want me doing it in their business, that's their decision. I'll go somewhere else. So
yeah, and most definitely, you now go from business to business, but originally you started in the school system, and then it translated into organizations, right? But that has allowed you to go into different higher learning facilities, and I know you work a lot with HBCUs,
I spent a year as a professor of diversity in residence at Bennett College, which is of course one of the two HBCUs for women. And I have to say, you know, when I was going down there, this is 2007, 2008. When I was going down there, I kind of half expected the students to be like, what is this? You know, bringing this old white guy to come teach diversity to us. But we ended up having, I would say, one of the most remarkable and fulfilling experiences of my professional career in the year I spent down there. You know, it was just an incredible experience. And I still have a handful are in support over the years. It's been more than 10 years now. I learned as much from them as they learned from me. So
yeah. So just from being, I grew up in Howard County. Mm-hmm. And so coming from Howard County mainly, you grew up in a melting pot of all kinds of different people. So my perspective is different. And one of my best friends is a white female, and she had the pleasure of teaching students at Coppin, which, is majority African-Americans. Mm-hmm. And the lifestyle differences, the mindset, the thought patterns, things of that nature, she was just recognizing the differences. And she grew up such as yourself, she wasn't wealthy, she wasn't poor, they had what they had. But did you notice any stark differences between the cultural behaviors between a white versus a black community?
I think it's really interesting, Nigel, because I think one of the things that I think is generally true for white people in our society is that when we're in a mixed group, the culture that plays out is the white culture. In other words, if you get a group of white people, a group of people of color, it's more likely the people of color will temper themselves and their culture to fit in with the predominant white culture than vice versa. This is just the nature of dominance in society. It's the nature of privilege and entitlement in society and what we would call supremacy. It's how supremacy plays out. But that's the operating program of the culture is white. One of the incredible blessings of that I've had in my career is to be in a number of places where I was the only. Bennett, teaching at Bennett was a great example. Another was that I was served on the Diversity Advisory Board for the Human Rights Campaign for 10 years, the largest civil rights organization in the world for lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people. And I was the only straight guy on that committee. And so in cases like that, I think it's such an amazing blessing because you actually get to experience and learn about the other culture much more than when everybody's accommodating to you. I wasn't in any way shocked or surprised because I have so many African-American friends and so many people who I've associated with over my life that I've spent a lot of time with people in their homes and their families. Sorry, I'm noticing the cat over your left shoulder.
No, you see?
That's okay. I'm sorry. I was just a little bit distracted.
This is just one of the twins.
But I think that the thing that really struck me and I ended up doing a lot of work with my students about was, the preconceptions that people have about the world they're going into, which are well-founded and well-grounded in things to be concerned about. But a lot of what we worked on in developing trust with each other was, how could they begin to distinguish between when they go out into business, for example, the white people who really genuinely want to be allies to them and really genuinely want to support them versus white people who are just saying that, but actually doing something else. And I think in that case, the fact that I represented the dominant group and that I'm a part of the dominant group allowed us to have some really deep and honest conversations about that. And to prepare them for going out there. And I know that many of them said to me, at the end of the program, it was very touching. We had the last day I was down there, I invited all of the students that I had for the two semesters, the two classes that I had taught, and took them out to lunch. And we just had a big kind of goodbye thing. And then my wife came with me because she wanted to meet everybody. And she's been my partner in business for many years anyway. And so she surprised me by having them each go around and giving me a little bit of an acknowledgement. And one of the things that they said time after time was, it's the first time I've ever really been able to trust a white man. Now, my response to that was, there are a lot of people out there you can trust. You just need to be able to find who they are. Because I think one of the challenges is, in order to be safe, sometimes it's easier to make all of them the enemy than it is to choose who's the safe one and who's not.
Yeah.
We see that happening right now with people around Islam in our culture. Because we know there's some Muslims who are dangerous, and that's an irrefutable fact. We have to understand that. But we also know, realistically, there are a very tiny percentage of the 1.3 billion Muslims in the world. But to the frightened mind, it's easier to say, keep them all away from me than it is to say, who's the dangerous one and who's the not dangerous one. And I think that that's something that I experienced as well. So in the end, it was an amazing learning experience, but we had to be really honest with each other in order to get there.
And it's ironic to me because a lot of times we'll do that. We'll say, okay, we're just going to shun the whole group. But there are good and bad people in every culture. So you'll accept your own culture, knowing that there are good and bad people in your culture, but you won't accept a foreign culture, knowing that there's good and bad in it. You just assume one way or the other. Now, you said something about the dominant race or something like that. When you were saying, when you go into the room, the white culture prevails because that's just how it is. Do you think that plays a part in the mentality of African-American youth when they say things like, oh, when you're speaking proper, you're speaking white?
Yeah, well, I think you know, it's understandable to me. You know, I mean, I grew up in something very similar. You know, my parents were afraid that we would lose our Jewish identity. And so, you know, they were seeing people who, you know, were children who were getting married outside of the religion, things like that. And it wasn't that my parents had anything against any other religions. It was that they wanted to preserve the culture that they thought, you know, was who we were. And I can certainly understand that among any group. I mean, African-Americans especially, you know, when we look at the history of our country and look at the fact that we had an entire system that for hundreds of years was designed to crush the culture that people came from and destroy any connection with that culture, it's completely understandable that people would want to hold on to that culture. And so when somebody appears to be abandoning the culture and going in a different direction by acting like, sounding like, talking like, looking like, marrying out of, you know, any of these ways that it looks like we're turning away from our culture, people who feel like it's important to preserve that sense of threat, they feel that, you know, we're going to lose what's precious to us. Now, the challenge is, of course, none of us are monolithic. And we're talking not about, even though we talk about this as separate, distinct groups at times, we know that it's actually a continuum. You know, it goes from people who are culturally very strong to people who have a mix of different cultures, depending upon what they've been exposed to. And people who grew up in middle-class environments, like you were talking about in Colombia, with people of, you know, lots of different races, will generally tend to morph into some kind of a, you know, some kind of a combination that reflects what they were exposed to. And so the tension becomes between people who think it should be a particular way and the way it is. When I started doing civil rights work, I was 15 or 16 years old, and I used to go over to Bowie, Maryland, to this church there to volunteer. And, you know, with just like three white kids who would go over there, and you know, we didn't know anything, but we were well-intentioned. And there was this wonderful woman there, her name was Maybelle Jones, and Maybelle was a large African-American woman who had come up from the South. She looked just like Fannie Lou Hamer, the famous civil rights activist, and in fact, they used to teasingly call her Fannie Lou. And Maybelle used to say, things ain't about what they're supposed to be, they're about what they is, you know? And that sort of became my mantra in my mind. Here I am 50 some years later, you know, sharing it with you. But I think that's what it comes down to. I mean, that people want different things, and some people adapt in different ways. And I think that we have to be able to see through our preconceptions and our notions about what that means and listen for what it means to the person involved. There are people who feel like they have to abandon their culture in order to be successful, which is something that I've fought against. In other words, I want people to feel like they can maintain their culture. And I've tried in working with the organizations that I've worked with over the years to say to them, for example, that people of color don't have to act white, should not have to act white to be successful here. You know, you need to learn more about people's other culture. But then there are also people who've been acculturated differently, and that's their natural way of being, talking that way. So I think we get into trouble when we oversimplify.
And most definitely. So, Howard, we have to take a brief break, but when we come back, I want to talk about some of the organizations that you've had the pleasure of helping to shape and their mindset and their culture within them.
Okay. So, sure.
All right. So we will be right back, you guys. Welcome back, you guys. If you're just joining us, we are I have the pleasure of speaking with Howard Ross, who is teaching me all kinds of things about the mindset when it comes to diversity and inclusion and the bias mind. So I want to jump right back in, because you went from teacher and activist and all kinds of things. But one of the things that you do currently is work with different organizations and the cultures within those organizations. So how did that all begin?
Well, it really started when I was teaching, as I came out of college and was teaching very young children, 2 through 12-year-old children, and eventually took over running a school program that I was in, that I was teaching in, and tripled it in size in a year, and found out that nothing that I knew about managing people worked anymore. All of a sudden, I went from having this sort of small group of people who, you know, I could be involved with each one of them, to having this large staff that I had to manage. And so out of my own stumbling and falling during that time, I started to study organizational leadership and management, organizational change, and began to apply that in our school, and we became very successful. You know, we became known as a really high quality program. And so other teachers and school administrators started to call me and say, gee, what are you doing? Can you come work with our staff? And so I was a single parent at the time too. So it was nice to get a little bit of, you know, extra money on the side. So I do a workshop here for $100 for a school, or for $50 over here for a school. But more than that, I started to see another possibility, which was to actually work with people, with adults on a scale that could really have impact on organizations. And I had the real good fortune of being introduced to a guy named Robert Allen, who was an organizational development theorist who created the Keep America Beautiful program, among other things. And Bob really believed in culture change in organizations, and he had been one of the early proponents of that. And so he became a mentor to me, and I spent a couple of years working with him with various different organizations to look at how do we build healthier cultures. And then at some point about 1985, I believe it was, Bob passed away. And at that point I went out on my own, and the two things came together, and we started to do the diversity work in organizations to look at how do we create culture and the cultures that are more inclusive. And did that for, you know, started Cook Ross in 1989 with a friend of mine, Dottie Cook, who was another practitioner, and who was actually only stayed for a couple of years because she got married and moved to Texas. And so we're still friends today, but we split up from a business standpoint, and continued to build the company. And then toward the end of the 90s, started to realize that there was something missing in the approach that we were using, which was sort of that old, you know, whack them with a 2x4 until they see the error of their ways. And if somebody cries, that's very cathartic. But the problem was, I would see those people a month later and they'd say, that was fine, but don't ever make me do it again. You know, they were left scarred and guilty and shamed by it. And it didn't change their behavior as much as it drove it underground. So that was what had me start to look at the unconscious bias conversation. And once we started to do that, and a lot of that came from, you know, both experiences that I had, and also beginning to, you know, spiritually expand by looking at things like Buddhism and Hinduism and Sufism, which look at identity in very different ways. Started to study the research that was coming out of Harvard and University of Virginia, University of Washington at that time, around unconscious bias and some of the new testing techniques. Some of our listeners might know the implicit association test, for example, that sort of thing. And then starting to look at some of the new brain research that was coming out. And, you know, I'm a little ADD, Nyjah, so if you put me here, I'll have a tendency to wander over here, here, and here. And, you know, I say to people, it wasn't by design, it's just by following my curiosity. And the more I would use those techniques, the more it would work. And so it sort of evolved in that way.
Yeah. Most definitely. I'm a little bit ADD too. It drives people around me crazy because I'm working on this and I'm working on this. That's just how my creative brain functions, and that's how I function best. And when there's other people that's more systematic and structured and have to stay in a rigid, straight line, it drives me crazy and it, you know, dampens my creativity. So I can understand it and I can appreciate that. Yeah.
But it's also, before we leave that point just for a moment, it's also a great example of diversity and the power of diversity, because when we can find somebody who's that way, who we can communicate effectively, we can work with. And I found that in my wife and business partner, Leslie Trout, that Leslie has much more of that kind of focus and able to kind of really get more into things. And it made everything that I wanted to do that much more powerful, because I could come up with this really great idea that she would say, okay, how are we going to make it work? you know? Yeah. And the combination of those two things was what I think had us be successful. I have no question in my mind that any success I've had is largely attributable to her and that partnership that we created and still have.
Yeah, that synergy, definitely. And I think it takes multiple types. That's why your network, I'm always preaching network and on this show, because your network is your net worth, mm-hmm. right? Because you got to surround yourself with the people who are better than you at a lot of areas. And a lot of people's pride keep them from surrounding themselves with people who can actually propel their life and their career and stuff like that. So that's how you started the business mm-hmm. side of it, which is focused on the organizational structures and things like that. Currently, you have a different business, correct?
Right. In 2018, we sold Cook Ross. It was part of a transition plan that we put in place many years before. We sold it to our third partner, Michael Emil Carr, who's an African-American woman and actually African-American Mexican. And we still have a relationship with Cook Ross. We still sometimes do work through the company, but we also started a new little company, Udarta, U-D-A-R-T-A, which is the Hindu word for generosity, just to continue to do our work. And we do other work as well. We do transformational leadership work, doing a lot of work around the belonging conversation. We do work all around the world. Last year, we did transformational leadership programs for people in Morocco and Costa Rica and Thailand and Mexico. And it was just time in our life to have a little, you know, less constant need to manage a company of 50 people. So that's the shift in name you're talking about.
Yeah, most definitely. So as we wrap up, Howard, this has been lovely, but I want to hear your thoughts on where you think diversity is going. But we have to take one more break, you guys. So you guys stay with us. And when we come back, we'll wrap up with Howard on where diversity is going and how they can get in contact with you. Sounds like a plan?
Thanks, Nigel. Right.
No problem. Welcome back. I am talking with Howard Ross, and we are talking about diversity. Now, Howard, this whole time, and speaking about diversity, a lot of it has to do with perceptions and your the environment you were brought up in, right? So if that mm-hmm. is the case, and that is the foundation of people's mindsets when it comes to relating to other individuals, where do you think that leaves diversity in the future with all of the things that are going on right now?
Well, I tell you, first of all, I think it's reasonable to say none of us can say with any surety what the future is going to look like, even the immediate future, because of the craziness that we're dealing with right now with COVID and everything it brings up. But at the same time, I think COVID has put in strong relief some of the dynamics of institutional racism in our society. I mean, when you look at the number of African Americans who are dying from this disease relative to white people and relative to their percentage in the society, it's tragic, and it's not by accident. And it's, we know the health disparities have been there for as long as we've been measuring it, for more than 50 years. We know health disparities have maintained themselves. And even as general health has improved in our society, the gap between health, especially between whites and blacks and Latinx people, has maintained itself. That gap has maintained itself. And we can see where COVID is concerned, how that happens. It's a combination of access, access to information, access to services, the environment people live in. For example, people who are low income and who live in the city, we know that a higher percentage of those people are of color than than not, tend to be exposed to environmental conditions that aren't as healthy, older cars, which produce more pollution, closer quarters, dirtier environments, all of which makes our lungs more susceptible to a disease like COVID. We know that one of the worst places right now where COVID is concerned is prisons. And we know that the mass incarceration of African-Americans contributes to the fact that a lot more of them are in those exposed environments. You know, we know that that goes right back to bias of police officers towards African-Americans, which is directly the people dying from COVID because they got tossed into prison. I mean, I could go on and on. We could do a whole show about all the factors that are involved.
Food deserts but, and everything else, yeah.
Oh, everything, you know, all that kind of stuff. Access to, and not to mention the fact that the rumor that went around for a while that COVID was not a black disease, it was only a white disease. And, you know, all of these kinds of things that have led to it, but they're not unique circumstances. This is what people deal with every single day, and that is that there's a tax on certain people in our society. There's a health tax on being black in our society, that just the stress of having to worry. You know, I was on the phone last night, my wife and I were having dinner, you know, one of our Zoom dinners that we like to have with our friends now, probably among our dearest friends in the world, who are an African-American couple, and she has a son from a previous marriage who's a grown man now. He's in his 20s and he's a big guy. He's like, you know, I'm 6'5" and he's taller than I am and he's bigger, you know. And we were talking about the Arbery case, you know, and she was talking about having to sit down with this 20 plus year old guy and remind him how careful he needs to be out there because of the world we're in. And it's just one more reminder, not like it's a new thing for me to hear this, but that I have the blessing, the privilege of not having to have conversations like that with my four sons. I mean, there are things I've had to talk with them about. There are things that they don't live in a danger-free life, but yeah, they never have to worry about walking out and getting shot or running. Three of my sons run. You know, I've never had a moment to think that they would get shot because they're white while they're running.
Yeah, or talking to my sons about how to get pulled over properly by
exactly a police officer. Where to put your hands, and the yeah whole driving while black conversation, which I never had to have with my son. So I think that, you know, we're seeing right now, I think that that's going to be back in front of our face again. And as every time, we have an opportunity in our culture to try to do something about it. Now, given the Trump administration has set us back, unquestionably, where race relations is concerned, it also has put the stuff right in front of our face and has taken away people's ability to say this ain't here anymore. You know, we had that whole conversation when President Obama was in office about post-racial America, this myth that because the president was elected, we are now in post-racial America. And what we see now is that it actually just spurred more of the white supremacy and white violent backlash. So I think we have an opportunity. And the question is, will we step into that opportunity? Will we confront the pain that this has brought up and say, this is one more time to roll up our sleeves and do more, or will we not? I think in the long run, the demographics are going where they're going, and you know, it won't be long before white people are a minority in this country. I think between now and that time, we may have some flaming resistance like we're seeing to that eventuality.
Well, that goes back to you saying that people are afraid of losing their culture, hence the reason they don't want them to speak a certain way or marry outside of a race. Is the same thing. If you're becoming the minority in a country that you have had dominance for hundreds of years, you're going to get that resistance.
And we have to also just accept the fact that and deal with the fact that we have a concerted campaign on the part of certain people. Tucker Carlson, Rush Limbaugh, Sean Hannity, Glenn Beck, people like this, to foment racial hatred, to foment this sense of paranoia among white people that you're going to lose what you've got. Even though, from a factual standpoint, if we look at any statistics, white people still overwhelmingly are dominant in terms of the amount of money we have, the amount of power we have, the amount of positions we have. All, you know, use any standard you want to have. There's no question white people's dominance has barely check itself. But if you look at polls and ask white people, is it easier to be white or black in this society? A majority of white people will now say it's easier to be black, despite the fact that there's all this data and evidence to suggest otherwise. So we have to figure out some way to have people deal with the real world around them and not the propagandized world that they've been told that they're a part of. And that's difficult in this bifurcated media environment that we're in.
Yeah, the media has done a horrible job at telling the right stories. They are, I mean, it's a business, and business goes to the what makes the most money and what get the most views and things like that. Hence the reason I'm so appreciative once again of WBGR Network and Total Entertainment Radio for letting me do what I want to do.
Yeah, it's great.
Which is great.
And you do it well, by the way.
Thank you. Yeah. I'm all about getting people information and exposing them to different mindsets and what it takes, and show that there are positive things going on in the world. There are positive people and things like that. Hence the reason I love the format of the show. It is what it is.
Yeah.
So Howard, how do people find you and get in touch with you, the business, the books, the things that you are involved in?
Well, two ways. You can go into howardjross.com. We have a website with my name. And they're also welcome to email me at howard@udarta.com. And I'll be glad to get back to them. I'm on Facebook and LinkedIn as well. So.
Absolutely. And very responsive, may I add.
Thanks.
So you guys, I appreciate you all joining me today. Howard, I appreciate you joining me today.
It's my pleasure.
So you guys, if you have any questions, if you want to reach out and ask Howard anything, definitely just write the show at getitgotitgoodg3@gmail.com. You can go to wbgrtv.com. You can comment on some of the posts that you'll see on social media any way that's possible. You guys, don't forget to follow Get It Got It Good G3 across all social media platforms. You can find us there. You can also follow me at Naja, NYSIA, Wilhite Carter, or Naja Wilhite Carter. I am all three. That is what it is, you know, multi angles of me. So you guys, until next week, I appreciate you all joining us once again. Thank you to my sponsors. Nail Fetish is coming back to you just soon. This social distancing thing stops, which I think we're going to be dealing with this for quite some time. It just is what it is. People need to get prepared for the long haul. Ultimately, the numbers are not going down, but the environments are opening up. So you guys definitely be precautious. I hate to say black folks, but black folks be precautious. We do have a lot of those underlying issues and things and, access. Yeah. So you guys definitely stay safe, stay healthy, take care, love one another. Nothing but love for you. Thank you, Howard, for joining us.
Thank you, Nigel. It's been such a pleasure.
No problem.
Cause all I ever wanted, cause all I ever wanted was left, left, left. And all we ever wanted was left, left, left. That's all I ever wanted. Little black boy with a big heart. Mama took me out the hood, but got my street smarts. Always had soul in my voice, that's the good part. And had a little sugar in my tank, that's the kickstart. Guess I always knew that this life would never be meant for me. Cause people like to indulge and they hate spreading their misery. I just kept it pushing, no time for negative energy. If we all got children, how the fuck is you better than me? Gave it up to God, cause something in me just ain't sit right. Trying to match up two puzzle pieces that just don't fit right. Cause the only one could judge me is the man from up above. So can't nobody tell me how to live and who to love. Cause my love flow like fluid. Y'all too scared to get your feet wet. I refuse to let niggas stop me from what I'm destined. They label me as gay and try to tell me that I'm less than. I'ma prove them wrong and keep these niggas second guessing.